Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hey everybody, due to the fact that a lot of times when I post these videos, especially my ending videos, I get a lot of questions and people start talking about the certain plot points or getting confused about things in the comments. So I'm going to try something new. I'm going to try answering some questions and pointing out some things I notice in the games at the end of my endings videos like this, and then I'll give my little opinion on the game. Anyway, first point. One of the most interesting things I found was specifically in the rec room. And that's how the author mentions that Aki is, in fact, either half-demon or, well, full-demon. Now, before the author tells you himself, there's not too many signs, although there are some. But the most obvious one, which you might not notice at first due to anime eye colors, is that during the beginning of the truth segment, she drops her contact, and her natural eye color is red. Now, from what we see, who else do we know has... who else has a red eye color? And that would be our friend, Onigawara. I'm not sure if they're perhaps blood-related somehow, maybe they're cousins, maybe he's her father, I don't know. But she's clearly a half-demon. I suspect this might have some influence on why she's able to succeed in the game and kind of interact with things to this extent without dying. And the author also points out that, from the dialogue with the library girl, that she only feels comfortable around her own kind, and she doesn't mean, well, it's a bit of a kind of joke where you can take it either as demon or, you know, eerie overtones. Probably both. Now, who is Onigawara? That's a common thing I see people talk about, especially on the Mad Father video. He's basically... he's your archetypical suave devil character. That's what they call them sometimes. He gains entertainment, from what we see anyway, from the events of the games of Mad Father and Misao. He may have ulterior motives, because we do see him working with the father in Mad Father, and if Aki's a half-demon, he may have some interest in, aside from entertainment and just being a troll, he may have interest in helping her out a bit. Perhaps giving her guidance, giving her the ability to save, and pretty much direct hints of what to do through the library, which is not part of the school, is its kind of own pocket dimension or something. Whether it's hell or not, I really don't know. Now, at the ending of the game, you'll notice that Toma is still stuck in what I can only assume is the afterlife, or a limbo. Or he's in the afterlife and then he gets transferred into limbo. Now, for you to understand what happened in the truth part of the game and what happened in the ending with Toma and all of them, it closely follows Buddhism, basically. Some schools of Buddhism, it depends on where you're from and what part of Asia you're from anyway, they believe in concepts of limbo, aside from reincarnation. It just, you know, it depends. And they even have differing opinions of how that limbo works. And in those versions of limbo, you can have some effect on whether you kind of, how you reincarnate and how you pass over, whether or not you remain like a hungry ghost or something. Which is what all the characters that were in that world were pretty much, were hungry ghosts or, there's another term for it, I forget it now, but basically rotten spirits. And when you entered into the truth world, you help them find... You influenced their reincarnative cycle, basically, and gave them a chance to re-enter it. That's why Onigawara says that they won't be revived, but they will be reinserted and possibly have a chance to be reborn. The exception, of course, is the teacher, who just seems to appear as a dead cat. And I'm assuming this is because he had the greatest amount of sin. He was, despite the game trying to set him up as being a tragic figure, he was pretty much an asshole. So he kind of screwed himself on that karmic cycle. There may be something for him down the line, but right now he's pretty screwed. But basically, they're in limbo right now, they're babies. I don't know why they haven't entered back into the cycle, and they might later. Maybe Oni has plans for them. I don't know, but Toma and our stereotypical blonde girlfriend here are raising them for the time being in the library. Now, I'm sure some people are gonna wonder what's the connection to Mad Father. Well, aside from Oni himself, there's not too much. But I do have a crack theory. It's really a shot in the dark. But I did notice that the Father at the end of Mad Father in the after credits scene had a kind of purplish hue to his hair. But that could just be something simple as reusing sprites, which is quite common in these variations of RPG Maker and RPG Editor and whatnot. But my theories, possibly, I don't actually 100% believe this, it's just something I keep up with my head, that the chainsaw figure could be the Father. If this takes place timeline-wise after Mad Father, then he could be now a demon. He could be kind of a vengeful ghost that Oni can kind of summon or use. But I mean, I'm sure when the creator made this, he didn't have much of a deep meaning to the chainsaw doctor we see here. He just thought, it'd be cool if I had this guy come in and he like chainsaws some people, because that's what they do in horror movies, man. I mean, that's probably the original meaning, but he might have added a throwback connection in Mad Father to that. I really don't know. And part of that crack theory I have is that the library girl is possibly the Aya we see in the tube, or the glass case, basically, that he had at the end of Mad Father. There's not much to really support that, but I just kind of noticed she mentions her father likes to do experiments, or he's like a scientist or something. And she has black hair. We don't see her eye color. She could be a demon, or she could be a more pure homunculus that lives possibly forever now. She doesn't have a name, and you get to name her, and that's kind of a classical demon thing where demons sometimes don't have names, and to make kind of a contract or for special reasons, the summoner gets to kind of name them or whatever. But it could be that the father never named her, even despite the fact he said Aya or whatever, or it could just be because, you know, it's crack fury. Now, another little thing, I'm not quite sure in the original translation, but I'm assuming that Onigawara was not called Ogre in Mad Father. I'm assuming he was possibly just called Oni, and they're usually translated as the same thing. But Onis, they don't look like that, but Onis usually, well, Onis sometimes are used as guardians of hell and things like that, almost like Cerberus, so that could be another kind of that hell connection there. Now, aside from that, I think that's pretty much all the points I wanted to go over. Yeah. I can't really think of anything that's I haven't played the male side of the game yet, so there could be some other little plot points or little Easter eggs there, but I'll check that out afterwards. As far as my thoughts on the game, I really liked, I forgot the name also. Misao. I really liked Misao. And I liked it more than Mad Father, if I had to compare the two games. I thought Misao has a very nice pacing. It's got some more gameplay to it. There's a little more threat of death, although it's kind of a comical death, like the phone death where you crash into a wall or something. It plays a bit like The Witch's House. Not as fancy, not as many graphical things or unique traps, but very similar. A lot of kind of cheap, out-of-nowhere deaths that... Well, you have the quick-save option, and that helps quite a bit. And most of the deaths are just kind of there to, like, you know, shock you or just make you laugh. So they're pretty much encouraging you to die, as morbid as that sounds. Compared to Eve, I would say Eve is better on more of a... I'd say on most levels. Misao I don't find very scary. It's scarier than my opinion on than Mad Father. But none of them are really that scary to me. There's a few jump scares, very minor. Both of them have these kind of very grim atmospheres. And Misao specifically is one of the few, well, few games period that I've seen kind of deal with bullying and rape. Although it puts him in a kind of B-movie horror plot. But I guess that's kind of typical sometimes. But I kind of like that. I kind of like it dealt with that. A little bit cliche, but it's pretty cool. Anyway, if you've stuck around this long and listened to what I've had to say, feel free to comment, ask any questions. I'll try to reply with the best of my knowledge. If you like this video, you know, feel free to subscribe, whatever. Although, that probably sound really cliche right there. If you like this segment at the end of the video, and, you know, also comment about that. Mention in your comment, because I would love to hear feedback, and if people like it, I'll kind of do things like these in other videos, or I will make them separate. But I thought this was a kind of a good place to kind of introduce something I've been wanting to do ever since I uploaded my Eve video. Well, that's it. Thanks for watching, thanks for listening. Take it easy. Avoid creepy teachers and, well, avoid creepy schools. See you later. Space Cowboy.